Hello everybody, welcome back to Cape Rugby TV here on Cape Town TV. We're live at 9 as we are, of course, weekly. Tonight, the gauntlet is laid down. We are laying down the challenge to you, the clubs out there, the players, the administrators. I'm looking for you to come to the party. The party I'm going to tell you about, I'll tell you about in a minute. Herman Abrams, Deputy CEO. Mr. H, you're looking tired tonight, Roy.
No, I'm not tired. I'm fine.
You okay?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, the weekend's rugby and all that took me by surprise. And
well, you don't win them all.
Yeah, but I must say, you know, just to go there quickly,
yeah.
The Lions were exceptional.
They did play well.
Yeah, and I want to congratulate my friend Darren, who's, you know, he's been going on about the Lions since day one.
Yeah.
That they will win the Currie Cup.
Yeah.
And on Saturday he was besides himself.
Besides him. But of course it took a guy from Paul Roos to come and help them do it.
Yeah.
A Stellenbosch boykie. Stefan de Tooy. Hello, Steph.
Hi, JP.
Nice to have you on board.
Yeah, thanks. First time.
I know. It's long overdue. We've been begging and trying to get you. But we know how busy you are. Of course, folks, Stefan de Tooy is the head fitness and conditioning coach at Western Province Rugby. Steph, you must be also in your chops.
Yeah, it's been a long year, a good year, I think.
Yeah.
We didn't have much of an off time for the players, especially getting them ready for Currie Cup, so that was quite challenging. But I think eventually we got to the playoffs. It was maybe the game we wanted to win most, which we didn't, but still it was a good season for us. I said to the guys when we lost to the Cheetahs in Bloom, it's been to that end and further beyond.
Yeah.
It's been the best couple of months of my 8 years at Province. So
I really
enjoyed it.
Well, we'll talk more about Province during the course of the show. Danny Jones, the chairman of Western Province High School. Hello, Danny.
Hi, JP. How are you doing?
Doing good. Nice to have you here.
Nice to be here, JP.
I mean, you're a club man through and through. You've been through the ranks. You know the ins and outs of Western Province rugby as well as the next guy. So.
Yeah, I know. Herman keeps me informed about all these things. You know, Herman is the line there. Everything happens. So he keeps me informed. And schools play an important role in Western Province. And we're happy to have this wonderful partnership with Western Province.
Yeah, you know, on the Cape Rugby Show, we've been talking so much about the fact that the Cape Rugby TV is about all rugby in the Western Cape area. And we've done so much club rugby, but we really haven't had a chance to focus on youth rugby. And we very seldom talk about the senior players, the Currie Cup players and that. And so it's fantastic to have you here, because I think from a youth rugby point of view, there's a couple of questions we'd like to ask and a few things we want to find out. And of course, that's where the future of Western Province rugby lies, is in the youth.
Absolutely. All 22 players who played for Western Province and the Stormers, they went to school.
Mr. H, is that a requirement when you register to be a club rugby player? Do they ask you, like, did you go to school?
No.
It should be, though.
Yeah, probably, but no. Anybody is entitled to register. But I can't believe in this day and age there's still people that, yeah, they didn't go to school.
Yeah, well, I don't know, Steph. But it does help, though. You know, I mean, let's talk to you. We've had you on the club rugby radio show. We used to get you on quite often, and we spoke about. And the one thing that I went on to mention with interviews with various international coaches, when we spoke to Peter de Villiers, when we spoke to Russi, and we spoke to Alistair, and we spoke to Chippy. The same thing came up again and again and again, which club players don't necessarily seem to understand, and you, I know, can elaborate on this, is that it's not so much about how big you are, it's not about how fast you are, it's about what you call the error rate.
I think if we can go back to your previous statement, you know, sometimes it's size and sometimes it's speed. I think the one thing you can really talent ID on is speed, and that is a really advanced skill set that you will have. So if we take a player like Gio, he's got a phenomenal skill set, speed, agility, quickness, and that makes him so good.
Yeah.
You know, but touching on the other things, error rate is massive, because the less mistakes you can make on the field, off the field, driving yourself, and those error rate is not only if you catch the ball or not, it's if you can manage yourself too. And that
off
is
the field also.
Off the field
but
also.
But if we just focus between the four white lines now, and we talk about error rate, because I think we still have this problem in club rugby where we tend to coach TV rugby in the club rugby space. And the two types of games are completely different. And club coaches don't necessarily understand that, in that you can't expect to be watched, and the fans for that matter as well, sometimes watch a club game and think, well, I'm watching a Super 15 game here, and we should be playing the same kind. But things happen differently in the club space. So when you talk about error rate, I mean, if we break that down just so people can understand it in practical terms, you're talking about things like, can you remember your role in a set move?
Exactly. Yeah.
So if it's like you must decide then, or must you pass the ball left or pass the ball right, that's what error rate is about. Was it more?
I think it boils down to a lot of things, and I can only speak on the conditioning side of it. And for me, in conditioning, error rate would be how you conduct yourself, how you carry on with the program. I leave you, you know, in the UK, they've got probably a ratio of conditioning coach to player of about 1-5 or 1-6. Yeah, we're sitting with 1-40. So the more
conditioning coach, one conditioning coach
to 40
per
players.
Five players.
That's what they have in the UK.
And you've got 40 players you've got to look
so
after.
My main focus is on education and educating the player. And by doing that and getting that right, I can spend so much more time on the player that need to see me one-on-one. And educating him more, his error rate should drop, because he can follow the systems and the procedures we've got in place. And touching a little bit on the coaching side, I can only speak a little bit on that, but there are plans on the field, and obviously you want your player to remember that and to be where he should be, and then again to make as few mistakes as he should or as he can, and obviously there are little or other external factors playing a role. Yeah. But error rate, and that's a Rassie's big word, and there's really a lot more to it than just catching and passing, and yes. He can maybe explain it to you more, but it's a really catching statement that he taught us.
Yeah.
And from that, we've brought it to other departments. You know, it goes to the technical
side.
You
sit with a clipboard and you go like mistake, cross,
no,
tip.
No, we do a lot of assessments on the players, and the coaches are really good at that. And they do pre and post assessments during the off season. Actually, we do more.
Okay, let's come back.
We need to work on it.
Let's come back to off season stuff. Danny, I mean, you know, when we talk about youth rugby, obviously, the first one thinks about is school rugby. It's about school. I mean, the reality is that you can't emphasize education more strongly enough in South Africa.
Absolutely.
I mean, from a youth rugby point of view, is that must be the first focus, is that you're going to school, you're doing well, and then you're playing rugby after that.
Yeah, that's for the bulk of learners. You also find that sport and rugby are a few of the reasons why they're actually in school.
Yes.
Because maybe some of them can't cope within the classroom situation, and then the love of the game brings them to school. Mm. But you're right, education plays an important role, because as you grow older, obviously you need to take certain decisions. You're speaking about the error rate.
Yeah.
So within that debate, the less errors you make, the better for your team. And by making less errors, obviously the opposition has less chance of capitalizing on your weaknesses and faults. So it is important then, obviously, that kids can read and write, and then also get involved around the importance of rugby, first the enjoyment part of it. And then as they grow older, it can become a vocation.
But if you just take it back to the school, to the classroom, also the ability to concentrate in the class and listen to what the teacher is saying, you can take that to the field, where you have to be able to concentrate on what the coach is saying, listen to what the coach is saying, absorb it, and remember it.
Absolutely. Look, they say that a 15-year-old learner concentrates on about for 40, 45 minutes. Mm. And so it's important that you understand that, because if you're coaching them, you also need to understand they have a retentive span.
Yeah.
And if you're going to go beyond certain time periods, you might lose them.
So, sorry, what were you saying?
The ability to respond well. Yeah. You know?
And my concentration span is about 3 minutes or so. So we're going to come back. But then, of course, not only to be able to, I mean, Steph, then not only to be able to sit in those video sessions that you guys do hundreds of, but to transfer. I mean, there was another phrase I remember working with Stanley Robenheimer and some of the other guys at the time, it was about what they call transference, being able to practice something in the video room, in the study room, what do you guys call it?
Just the AV room.
The AV room, yeah, the video room, technical space. But then to be able to transfer those skills onto the field.
I think that's you hit the nail on the head. That's exactly what it boils down to.
Mm. Yeah. So die spijker op je kop geslaan.
Exactly.
Okay, that would be in the other phrase. Folks, right, it is time for me and Mr. H to have a little chat now about the fact that some clubs have not quite come to the party yet. The party we are talking about has been started off with Tata. Tata once again have led the way and shown us how to do it. On the 29th of November, there will be at the HPC a function for the kids, for the less advantaged kids. Kids that have never had a chance to see Western Province rugby players, kids that have never had a chance to experience their heroes in the flesh. And this is their one opportunity. Over the last few months, the clubs have been having a fantastic time, and it's now your chance to give back to those clubs. We've seen other organizations, radio stations, newspapers, motorbike gangs doing it. Delivering toys. It is now up to you to step up. So Tata have come to the party, and let's take a look and see who exactly is on the scorecard so far, because the challenge has now been laid down and we are looking for you.
You changed my view.
Right, so as I said, Tata together with Rotary, Ivan Lindner and his team, they do such great work. This is our first bag, all right? And then we don't only have to do toys, folks. Mr. H, let me start with you, seeing as you look rather sad tonight. I know I have to try and do something to keep you happy. Okay, so there's a little teddy bear for you with a little jersey on.
Thank you.
Okay, and then here's a little teddy bear with some bunny ears. I'm sure that will make some kid very happy. Are there girls coming?
Yes.
Girls mix. Coming? Tell us a little bit more about the day again.
We have, over the past year, we brought quite a number of children from various homes to Newlands.
Yeah.
And we've told them all those that are very good for the rest of the year will be invited to the party. So there will be about 200 to 300 kids there.
Yeah.
And
some of those kids don't even have toys.
They have no toys. They sit in homes. They have no parents. They have caregivers.
Yeah.
Some of them are mentally challenged. Others, they are disabled.
Yeah.
So we bring them and we want to just give them a little cheer. And hopefully in that way we can change
and
their lives.
Everybody at home actually has got something. Whether everybody. It's a tin of beans or a loaf of bread, some pocket money. I mean, folks, I've actually explained this before to you before. This is a fantastic opportunity for you to teach your kids a little bit about giving and sharing. All right? When you do that, they learn to share. And then they learn to form part of the organization. And that's what rugby is all about. It's about sharing in the community, sharing on that team when they're playing against another squad. So, guys, really, we need you to come to the party. Let's take a look at some of the clubs that have come to the party so far. So there you have it. Temperance on the board with R1,000. The challenge is laid down. These are some of our donors so far. Primrose, R3,000. Thank you very much, guys. Solarians, R3,000. Milnerton came to the party with R3,550, topping Solarians there. And Belha, R4,000. Belha, fantastic stuff. Thank you very much. And Roy Jacobs, in his personal capacity from Belleville, has also made a contribution. Right, folks, so there you have some of the clubs that have managed to come to the party. We are on Facebook right now, www.facebook.com/CapeRugbyTV. All you need to do is jump on the Facebook page and just let us know. Can you help out? We're not forcing you to help, but it would be absolutely fantastic if you can help. There you see at the bottom of your page right now, www.facebook.com/CapeRugbyTV. I always have to do this in reverse. Let's take a look at some of the other toys we got you. Mr. H?
Yeah, I just want to say that whilst on my way here, I've had calls from Hamilton's?
Cales River.
Cities, they are all on board. They will by hopefully, if we're still here next week,
yes,
that list will be quite long.
So we'll have quite a long list. And of course, we're happy to give publicity to these clubs. Hamilton's Rugby Club, Dave Kagan probably phoned you.
Ralph Mahoney,
Ralph Mahoney. Of course, some of these clubs were the clubs that we featured and supply sponsorship to on the show. We looked after you on the TV show. So there's another little teddy bear. Stefan, you're of course going to be there on the day. So quite a few of these teddy bears are those that you stick to the. It's a fact. There's a little lion.
Lion.
We'll hand that over there. So guys, there you go. This one looks like a South African flag. Anyway, so there are all the teddy bears so far, courtesy of Tata.
Danny's crying. Danny's crying.
Danny hasn't got a toy yet. Look at that.
And this is a unicorn.
Yeah, Danny.
Hey, isn't this just fantastic? We'll just throw these out, yeah. And, yeah. So, teddy bears up for grabs. Mr. H, on the night, though, I think this is my absolute favorite. Mr. H, this one's for you. Can we get a zoom in on this one? If at all possible, on the camera there, zoom right in onto the teddy. And see closer, see if you can see what it says right on that little badge there. All right, that's about as max as we can get. But on that badge, Mr. H, it says, I love you. Okay. So that doesn't mean you can take the home, eh? All right. So look at this, guys. Teddy bears, this is looking like a toy shop. All right, so to the guys from Tata for starting the ball rolling. And folks, we've got five more bags. Okay, I feel like somebody on Idols. Five, vote for me on five. We've got five more bags like this of toys. There's 200 toys that we're gonna hand out of the High Performance Center on the 29th of November. I'm gonna jump on Facebook. I'm gonna see how many of you guys have decided to contribute, all right? If you can contribute, all you need to do is drop off those toys at the Western Province Rugby Football Union. Mr. H will be waiting for you. And if you can make a monetary donation, of course, to follow the proper procedures there, you'd have to get hold of Mr. H as well. And we'll give that telephone number to you a little bit during the course of the show. But I'm sure most of you have his number already, especially if you're playing club rugby. Mr. H, just on the day of the event itself, it's not just... What's happening? What are you doing?
Well, the kids will, you know, we'll put up jumping castles, we'll have face painting, we'll have a magician, we'll have all kinds of games that they can play.
Yeah.
And then we'll have Father Christmas, and we'll have... And we'll give them toys. We'll give... I think the whole day they look forward to getting that goodie bag.
Yes.
And I just want to say to the people out there, when we are finished, we'll take what's left over and distribute it to other deserving homes and children.
Danny, does it make a difference to the kids to get this kind of support or experience from a rugby player or...
Absolutely, JP. If you, a large part of our community, know the poverty is there, and I'm sure that any child, any toy is important to them. And so when they, you know, the toy is just the token, it's the appreciation and the fact that somebody out there cares.
Yeah.
That's the most important thing. And that by giving this to a child, the child feels that at least somebody out there loves them.
Yes.
And that goes, I mean, there's no amount of money that can actually... take away those tears when somebody receives those gifts of gratitude.
And for many kids, it's a big thing to have a toy, as especially for kids who come from an abused home or perhaps have never had a toy, it becomes almost like a friend.
Absolutely. That's true. You find that many kids where abuse has occurred, that they cling to something.
Yes.
And sometimes it's a blanket, and most times it's a toy.
Yeah.
And that toy represents some form of security and belonging.
Yeah.
So yes, I would agree with you that these gifts go a long way to making kids feel at home and also welcomed.
And Steph, from your point of view, Mr. H playing there, but you know, Danny mentioned something interesting there, the sense of a feeling of belonging and a feeling of sharing. And that really is what rugby's about. I mean,
exactly.
when you guys are playing rugby, people often say, commentators say, that they're playing for each other. But that's a fact, right?
JP, that's massive. I mean, a player like Robbie Fleck, that's part of our management now, he's come...
He's the African Grey.
That's right.
He's the African Grey,
We won't elaborate on that.
We won't elaborate on that.
Let's keep it there.
The African Grey.
That's right.
Robbie Fleck.
otherwise known as.
AKA.
Let's go back to culture. You want to create something for the player to want to stay. And with him coming through the Western Province schools and playing eventually for South Africa, his big focus, and I think his primary internal drive is to make sure that Western Province culture gets carried over from player to player, and playing for each other eventually overshadows a team maybe with less talent, because you will die for that player.
And that, which is for me so much more important and so much more reason then that we need to make sure that the club rugby players play for Western Province. The West, Mr. H, that's what we want, right? We want, what we actually want to see is schools rugby, starting with Danny's guys, getting into the club space in Western Province and not leaving, and then going from the club space in Western Province and not leaving, and playing for Western Province and not leaving.
No, that's exactly what we want to see. But we must also understand, you know, that it's very rare that a guy will go right through to the top.
Well, you've got 17,000 players. You're not going to get every guy who goes.
I look at the team that I was the manager of, the Craven team under 13. The only one that made it out of that entire year's all the under 13 players is Jean de Villiers. If you look at, on the other hand again at a guy like Corne Krieger, he played under 13, under 15, under 18, under 19, under 21.
Yes, Western everything.
And you know, so it can happen. Yes. Can happen. You must just, you know, sort of.
Well, not everybody's going to play for Western Province, but at least everybody who plays for Western Province hopefully would have come from our ranks. Yeah. And we'll touch a little bit.
All players must always hope and wish that they can play in the Western Province team.
And hope and wish that one day they can play for the Springboks.
That's right. They must never give up that, you know.
So someone like you should actually never play for the Springboks if you support the French team.
Yeah, but I support the French team in the absence of the Springboks.
Okay, right. So if you're an All Black supporter, you'll never, ever play for Western Province.
No. Never. Never.
Danny, is that something we should do at school level already? Is like sign a form? I hereby oath my allegiance to...
I'm not a believer in that, but I do believe that what Stefan said, the you know, brand Western Province, the culture of, you know, the culture of provinces, give us 20% possession and we win the game because the brand that we play, get it out wide, score the attractive tries, go to the line, the beach on a Sunday afternoon. I think that's important, where those kinds of nuances we must create. Mm. And I think also is that if we spoke about belonging, if schoolboys feel that they belong in province and they've been looked after, etc., etc., they wouldn't necessarily leave the province to go to another province. Yeah. And you similar know, to that of you know, supporting South Africa.
And it's interesting that you mentioned that sense of belonging, because I spoke to Mr. Tuobi Titus, the president of Western Province. I bumped into him in the road the other day, and he said that since we started this TV show, there has never been such in the history of Western Province, such a sense of belonging to an organization that people can associate with. And that, I mean, I actually dream that we would see club rugby players who all put a jersey on, that they have the Western Province logo on their jersey one day. For me, that would be something fantastic. But it really is a sense of belonging. And the youth feel like they belong to the seniors feel like they belong to the organization. And that's what we're looking for, right?
Absolutely. And I think Western Province is succeeding, and the Stormers is definitely succeeding in that. Because if you look at the stadiums on a Saturday, when the Stormers play, you know, it's I think, if I'm not mistaken, that the Stormers is the most watched team by stadium population.
Yes.
And so that must count for something.
Yeah.
And it's been going like that for the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years.
And that is absolutely fantastic. And now we've managed to, I think, multiply those numbers by 20. So we are certainly increasing the amount of people who are getting exposed to Western Province rugby. And that is you out there. And I'm coming to check on Facebook to see how many of you guys have jumped on. Incidentally, if you've got any questions for Stefan de Toey, folks, for the next half hour or so, we are going to heavily focus on nutrition and gym training, all right? The off-season is on you now. You're going to soon be finishing up with off-season. And then before you know it, you'll be busy with pre-season. And before you know it, you'll be back on the field. Stefan de Toey will tell us more about that. But we're going to go to an ad break. And when we come back from the ad break, We'll have a chat with Stefan about nutrition, gym and other factors on and off the field. So if you're a coach and a player, stay close by. Well, folks, as you know, nutrition, training, off-season preparation is one of the most important factors for playing rugby. Many of the clubs getting ready for next year's season already, and it is not an easy road. Remember, we had Jody Birch from SK and from the captain of the Western Brahmins amateur team on the show 2 weeks ago, and he said he was taking a one-week break before he was back in the gym. But it does take a little bit of technical experience. It takes a little bit of skill and expertise. Mr. H, some of that skill and expertise you have managed to enlist at the world-renowned Sports Science Centre here in Newlands.
Yes, there are 30 clubs that will be, they are busy being tested. But unfortunately, three of them already didn't turn up.
But now why, hang on, are you telling me, you're telling me this again, that you've managed to secure free expertise, free training, free gym experiences, free conditioning programs? We went through this last year where 30 clubs had this opportunity, and we've got this happening again now. And some of the clubs who quite often we know say Western Province doesn't do anything for the clubs, which we've completely eradicated this year because we've seen what Western Province has done, especially with the union on the spot feature. Are you telling me that some of the clubs haven't actually taken up this opportunity?
Three failed to even apologize that they didn't come. They were phoned the afternoon to establish that they will be there. They didn't pitch.
Were they notified before the afternoon as well?
They decided on which day they must come.
Yeah.
And they were notified and reminded that they must be there. They didn't pitch.
Right, folks. Well, there you have it. Don't complain. You get an opportunity, you don't take the opportunity, especially if that opportunity is free and Western Province has organized it, then make sure that you grab it. On Facebook right now, here's a question here from, Hisham Kamaldin writes, thanks guys for an amazing show. Didn't even know about the show. Oh, Hisham, we've been around for a while, but glad to have you on board. Just imagine seeing my old primary school principal on CTV. Hey, Mr. Abrams, Sham. Mr. H, yeah. Has this happened a lot, that people come to you in the street and say, you were my Oni?
Yes. I remember the naughty ones very distinctly.
Can you remember what's Hisham?
I remember.
Was he naughty?
He was a naughty boy, yeah.
Stefan, let's go to you. It's time to talk a little bit more about training and nutrition. And Hwapi Iso posted on Facebook, at Stefan. So this is actually a question and a statement. Do you only do conditioning for the top side or up to under 21s? And besides the top coaches, who are the other coaches you have liked to work with? I.e. Jerome Parvata, Labib Levy, Kennedy Ford, Peter Rousseau. Have you worked with any of them? And if so, who do you like working with? So a double question there. Do you only do that up to under 21 seniors, or do you do under 21s? And some of your memories on the coaches.
I started at under 21 Vodacom Cup, Currie Cup, then moved up to Super Rugby. But I'm still very involved with our elite under 16 and 18 teams. And today we had an hour and a half session with them, describing programs, testing them. So I'd like to keep my hands in there because that's where the talent starts.
Yeah. And elite under 16s?
Yeah, Henny Becker, they identify, I call it under 16s, they actually call it under 15, but they would play under 16 the following year, and then they would actually be under 17 for under 18. And I arrange with Wilfred Kibiro and Henny Becker the testing session. We test them, put them through a testing battery. We work through the results, they come back, we give them each programs, but most of them are with school, so they've got programs already. Those are for the guys that really don't have anything, and the rest of them can put it in their
just
door.
Just quickly, you mentioned names like Wilfred Kupido and Henny Becker. For the folks out there, obviously those are names that we know, but what do they do in the union?
Maybe Mr. H can maybe explain a bit on that.
They are part of the School of Excellence,
right?
Which is sponsored by Toyota,
right,
to look especially after talented kids.
Right.
Pick them out, put them in the programs that Stefan is talking about, and make sure that, you know, they follow their pathway.
The very next question, obviously, that we're going to get is, are the kids coming through and getting those opportunities? So, Danny, I've got to ask you that question, because that's what people are going to say, is who is getting which of the youth, and what are the structures in place to get sure that some kids that have got the talent get the opportunity?
At high school level, we have an under 15, we have trials. and under 15 trials are specifically there so that the kids could go to the school of of excellence.
Okay.
And then those kids who made the under 16 Grand Como, in the following year they would form part of the under 17, under 18 elite group.
Okay.
So it's a very inclusive process in that schools, from when we start our trials the first week in May, schools are aware of those trials taking place. They send players to the trials, and then obviously the selectors of those various age groups, they would then forward names to the School of Excellence,
okay.
who would then contact the schools and get the players in, where Stefan and Wilfred and Henny would then you know, test them, coach them, etc., etc.
Okay, so there is a little bit like Jerome is doing, there's a talent identification process in place.
Yes, definitely.
All right. Folks, going back to the Facebook page now, a question came in here from Melrich Steenkamp. And the question is there no gym programs available? What's the use of going to the gym but not knowing what to do, or rather how much to do in terms of sets and reps? Steph, I'm not even going to ask you that question. Melrich, if you go to the Western Province Club Rugby website, you'll go to the downloads section and you click there, and in the download section there's actually a set of programs, off-season, pre-season programs, gym programs for different youth groups, age groups that you can download, and all your programs are available there on the Club Rugby website, which came from Stefan and Greg Hechter at Western Province Rugby.
I must say we will update them, and we had another request yesterday.
Yeah.
And I think those are a little bit old, but they still work. I mean, there are many ways to skin a cat and to get to the ultimate goal.
Okay, but now let's talk about that. I mean, you say they're a little bit old, but I, in my experience, sometimes old stuff is best stuff.
JP, there's a basket this big of stuff that works.
Yeah.
It's just a matter of, do you like this program or not? Do you benefit from it? Do you have fun with it? You know, there are so many patterns. There's not just one pattern. But in order to work power, strength, muscle endurance, muscle hypertrophy, there are though different sets and reps that you must
do. Okay, let's keep it more basic. Let's keep it more basic in terms of the club player. So I'm going to ask you a couple of basic questions. First of all, coming out of a club rugby season, so now let's not look at Stormers and Western Province. Coming out of a club rugby season, they're only going to be playing again in April, even though there are some guys getting ready for the Varsity Cup. Coming out of a club rugby season, how long do you rest?
We only take off between 3 and 4 weeks.
Is that enough?
If you have a niggle, manage the niggle, get rid of it, because we want players on the field that can train maximally.
Right.
If you have a current injury, sort it out, either physio, surgery, etc. If you want to take a week off, the biggest fatigue comes from mental fatigue, day in, day out.
Yes.
Than physical fatigue. If you can manage your body well, you've got good nutrition, you sleep well, you rehydrate well.
Okay, let's look at this from another point of view then. Player comes out of club rugby, he's fit, he's got no niggles, he needs no surgery, he takes a rest for, let's say, 2 weeks. Surely the first thing that he needs to do, considering he's got 3 months, is he needs to hit the gym.
He needs to test first.
Test.
So in order for you to see if your program is working, you have to have a baseline test, whichever way you want to do it. If you just want to work on maybe your problem is weight, not saying your problem is weight, JP.
Well, incidentally, Gershon Trussell wrote on Facebook now, "Hi, I stopped playing rugby at under 19 level. I picked up 25 kilos in the last 8 years. I tried to play again, but simply can't regain my fitness, no matter how hard I try. But will not stop eating that whole Gatsby."
That is a problem.
Yeah.
No, it's not. If we go down to... Okay, well, let's leave the Gatsbys out of this. Okay, so you establish for yourself a baseline. In some cases, surely it can be as simple as checking the size of your belt.
Exactly, or just making a note on your program about a weight you've pushed for X amount of reps.
Yeah.
You don't have to test today and only in 4 weeks' time. You can test weekly. You can test 2 weekly. It doesn't matter. You don't have to only test now and 6 weeks later.
Can it be as simple as just getting on the scale and making sure you've got a starting point?
Exactly. Exactly as simple as that. Making sure the size of the shirt you wear. Making sure the size of the belt you use.
Okay, so now you've got your starting point, whether it's a belt, jump on a scale, or even just looking in the mirror.
That's right.
Starting point. Okay, now you start going to gym. You've obviously got to decide what it is you want to do. Do you
exactly.
want to lose weight or gain weight?
That's right. Do you want to get stronger? Do you want to get fitter? Do you have work on your flexibility? You've got to decide.
We've got a situation generally in Western Province where people say a lot of Western Province rugby players are too small. They're too small to play, and that's why we play running rugby. Not that I have a problem with that, but let's just look at the gaining weight scenario, because it seems to me that quite a lot of players will hit the beginning of the season, and after that, there's no more time for gaining weight because you've got to get through the season. By the end of the season, you've lost 10 kilos. So surely during the off-season, you've got to gain as much weight as you can.
You have to. Normally, they say you lose about 10% of your strength. Sometimes players pick up weight during the in-season, but I think it's a mixture of mindset and ability. Ability coming back to, do you carry a niggle after the weekend? You cannot gym then. And if you don't, get your mind in the right frame and hit the gym. You know, you can do between 1 and 3 sessions a week still in season.
Can you train, if we just look in terms of, let's say as a basic example, I know maybe it's very simple, yeah. If I go and do bench press, I surely have to wait long enough to recover the muscles properly before I do bench press again.
Exactly, but that still now depends on muscle endurance, strength, power, or muscle hypertrophy. So
right.
There we need to
Mas,
be...
What the hypertrophy?
Hypertrophy, gaining...
Something like a hypertrophy sounds to me like a really big World Cup trophy.
Exactly. That is right. No, it's just a matter of picking up lean body mass, which will mostly be muscle mass.
So you want to put on the muscle mass. So you got to hit the gym and you got to train. Do you train as hard as you can? Like, do you train to failure, or do you just like pick up a few weights and throw them around?
You have to train hard, but not always hard, if you can understand that. Your body needs time to recover, and you will find after a while, if you only go to gym and you hit it at a maximum level or at a top weight in your spectrum the whole time, that you will sometimes see after weeks that you will keep on training harder, but your performance will just drop. And that's a sign from
overtraining?
Overreaching, probably.
Yeah.
More, not so much overtraining. And by doing that, sometimes I tell the guys, take a whole week off, and they come back stronger than what they left.
Right, so some because the muscles have managed to recover.
Exactly. They obviously say the harder you train, the bigger the gain. But it's not always
true. Not always the case. Yeah. You can never train a broken muscle.
100%. But then there are, in a simple way, you can have hard, medium, and light days. And we can elaborate on that later.
All right. Danny, one of the obvious things about gaining weight, I mean, apart from gym, is quite simply eating. How much of a challenge do we have amongst the youth that they don't necessarily have the money or the opportunities that some people have had in the past, for example? How are we doing in terms of development, put it that way?
I think it's a good debate to have that we find that kids from poorer communities, they find it tougher for various reasons. And I think a lot comes down to diet, but I do believe that poor doesn't imply that you don't eat correct. I mean, poor, you find that in poorer communities, they might not have all the specialist foods, but they do get a good meal.
Yes.
And I think the importance is the ratio between eating well, training, and expertise. And I think at schools, that's the big problem, expertise. The ability of teachers to engage learners around what's best for them around sport. And I don't think necessarily all teachers are equipped to deal with the ratio of, you know, nutrition, exercise, and then, of course, a sound mind.
Sound mind is, of course, the key thing. Unfortunately, sound minds is not something we have a lot of here on this show. Except for maybe some mind sounds, which I sometimes have because I have voices in my head. Mr. H, yes, you
want to ask a question?
Sure, of course you may. Now you sound like I'm your teacher.
Yeah.
If you want a question, you put up your hand.
Earlier you said, you know, the first step would be to look in the mirror.
Yeah.
But you'll be topless.
I think it's probably a good idea, yeah.
I'm just visualizing all those guys, you know.
Yes, I could see you visualizing all those guys. Can we please, this is a family show, if you're visualizing a lot of guys,
not
okay?
Not girls.
Oh, you visualize it. Girls and guys can stand in front of the mirror, yes.
Yeah.
Not at the same time, you must do it in your private time.
Oh, okay.
JP, I played rugby when I was younger, and when I look in the mirror, now I see the same person.
That's
as
right.
Lean and mean as ever.
Yeah, that's that old picture. You must take that picture off the mirror. Folks, but talking about nutrition, one of the companies that has managed to help us and of course helped the Stormers through the last for the last few years are the guys from Evox Advanced Nutrition. Lots of different shapes and forms, but protein is the only thing that recovers muscle. There's nothing else. There's no other molecule on the planet that helps you recover muscle. Every time you gym, every time you run, every time you cycle, no matter what type of physical activity you do, you're breaking down muscle fiber. The only way you can repair it is through protein. It's the only thing that can fix it, and you need to start looking at eating, all right? In the event that you can't eat enough, the rule of thumb that is out there is quite simply eat anything.
That's right.
Eat like a horse, Steph. If you don't have the luxury,
go for it.
Just eat.
Just don't skip a meal.
Don't skip a meal.
Yeah.
There's nothing worse than having a half a tank.
Oh, that's the worst. You don't get anything out of the player.
So it's very important. Well, you don't, like you say, you don't get anything out of the player. But of course, your body doesn't have anything to use to recover and then starts to break itself down.
It's a snowball effect. So tomorrow, you cannot recuperate that as quickly as you've lost it. Sometimes you can if you go regularly, but if that's your pattern, you're going to come short somewhere. But
bottom line, yes.
JP and Steph, but you say eat. That's what Gershwin did. And he gained 25 kgs.
Yes, but the harder you eat, the more you train. The more you train, the harder
that's
you eat.
Right.
I mean, Tim Noakes himself has come out and said, you can train as hard as you want, but if you don't have proper nutrition, you've wasted your training.
Gone.
So then don't train. Rather don't train if you're not going to eat properly. Anyway, folks, of course you can win yourself a bucket of Mega Grow. This is one of those bulk meal replacements. It's high in protein, high in carbohydrates. All you need to do is tell us who's the official sponsor to Western Province Rugby, official sports nutrition supplier, which is not hard to work out. This week's winner of the Evox hamper, Claude Fisher. Congratulations, Claude. Wins 5 kilogram bucket of Mega Grow. The guys from Evox, the official suppliers to the Stormers, will be in touch with you and they will hand that bucket over to you. Right, so all you need to do is SMS the word Evox to 32010. Just send that number in. And by the way, all club rugby players, you are all entitled to get stock directly at sponsorship rates from the guys at Evox. Okay, so from Evox, that's all you need to do is if you want to find out how to get your guys on a proper nutrition regime, if you want to get those sponsorship rates, just get hold of the guys at Evox. Okay, it's very easy. In fact, I'm pretty sure that you can join us on Facebook and ask for those details, or you can just SMS that number, the word Evox and 32010. And they'll also get hold of you there. Steph, just from a nutrition point of view, how much of a role does nutrition supplementation play in the Western Province rugby team?
Fairly large. we obviously try and get them on a healthy lifestyle first, because they have to start with a good breakfast. That breakfast does include supplementation already. So he'll have his protein with his oats in the morning.
Of course, there's no point in even using supplements if you're not trying to eat properly first.
See, they've got a saying that a poor diet supplemented is still a poor diet.
Yes.
You know, but for us being on the road, being away in a hotel, it's easy because there are always food. But still, at times when you want convenience and at times when you want those supplements in quickly, and you can only eat so much chicken.
Yeah.
You understand? And for me, the other way to do it, and for us that works, is supplementation.
You know, gehoor, Mr. H, that kikkel and kraai kuierkies moet nou in kry, ne?
Yeah.
So, you've got nothing to say. It's still scum. Is it what you feel? Hoender yet. But now, let's just look at some of the other products. I mean, when you look at sports nutrition supplements, obviously meal replacements and proteins are the things that you should be taking at least every 2.5 to 3 hours per day between your meals. But you also use other products like creatine and recovery drinks and
yes.
So on.
Different times of the year though. And we use good products like No Cramp, Joint Support. We use branch chain amino acids. We use the Mega Grow Plus. We use the Synergy Whey, which is a great product for us. For the players that especially we don't want too many carbs in their supplements.
Well, that was my next question for you. Is there a difference in the type of protein? Because we know that, like, for example, this Mega Grow's got carbohydrates in it. Mm. And then you look at a Synergy Whey protein or 100% whey protein has got no carbohydrates in it. Is there a different type of product that you might prescribe for, say, a forwards player and a backline player?
Yes, depending on the goal you want him to achieve. Is it muscle? Is it maintenance? Is it increase or decrease? And a lot of players just think that a bucket like that has got the same content from bucket to bucket, but you've got to start reading the labels.
Are these products
picking the right one?
When you talk about reading the labels, are these products safe to use? Have you ever had in your time a player tested positive for anything?
No, not with us, and that's why we go with Evox.
Is it important to us? Is it important for a coach to use a product that's been endorsed by the manager, the team, the conditioning coaches?
It would be to his benefit. Ultimately, the supplement usage still stops with the player. So the player still takes full responsibility, even if he has been advised to take something.
Yeah.
So it's still his choice. But I can say with the greatest respect that we've only had good results. And saying it again, that and gymnasium work goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
You have to marry both.
But you, of course, want to control the player's environment. You don't want the player experimenting outside of the instructions that you've given him.
For sure, and that's where the education part comes in, where you have to educate and he makes less errors by picking the right product and by following the product that you give him. So it's a dual purpose or outcome goal process.
Yeah, but if the player is using the endorsed product, then at least you know he's not out there experimenting with something.
Exactly.
He's using what you've guided him
exactly.
on to.
All right.
Yes. And Danny, the bottom line is not everybody can afford these supplements, but if you can eat, it's important to have a good breakfast, a good lunch, and a good supper. And that's where family comes into it.
Absolutely. No, that's true. That eating plays an important role. But I'm sure that parents would cater for breakfast and a good meal. It's a problem is lunch, because not many school kids, you know, these days parents give their money, and if you look at tuck shops, you find that the goods sold in tuck shops are actually quite horrific. You look at the amount of sugar content.
Yes, there's absolute rubbish, sweet drinks and things like that. There's no place for that at all. Folks, in terms of a little bit of nutrition advice that I've managed to give people in the past, is do not start your day with breakfast. Here's where you start your day. You start your day at night with dinner. So an easy tip for you is all you do, because at least you're at home, so you can cook the kind of food that you know is what you're, and Stefan, I'm sure you'll back me up on this, but you know you've got your food at home, and always go shopping, look at the labels, buy the right stuff, never forget to look at the labels, but start at night. Then you cook a little bit extra. And Danny, to answer your question then, mensen, dit is baie maklik. En al wat jy doen die volgende oggend is jy sit 'n bietjie van gisteraand se kos in 'n kosbakkie. And that way you've had breakfast at home, you've taken your dinner from the night before on the road with you, now you've got your kosbakkie. And then when you're back home in the evening, so you've controlled all three your meals.
You are so right. I mean, your advice we give to professional players and they do it.
Yeah.
It's obviously easy if you have a girlfriend and a wife.
Well, you do need a support structure. I know you, that maybe sounds like a joke, but the reality is that it's a good idea to go shopping together.
Exactly.
Looking at the labels together. Look how much protein is on the tub.
That's right.
A ton of tuna or things like that.
Look at the sugar. Look at the carbohydrates. Look at the protein. Look at the fat content. Look at is it saturated, unsaturated fat type of thing. So that's where the education comes in. I can't go shopping with everyone. And the player, when he goes out, and if he's single, he makes the right choices.
Folks, well, there you have it. We will touch a little bit on things still during the course of the next couple of shows. In the meantime, it is time for us to take a little ad break. And when we come back, don't forget, we have got Colour Tone paints. Colour Tone, well, they have been supporting us during the course of the show. So what do we do? Let's go there right now. Colour Tone paints, the White Line Sports Line field marker of choice. This is what you want to get for your club. Colour Tone paints, of course, supply those white lines that you see around the field. They are environmentally friendly. If you want to win yourself a Colour Tone Sports Line marker, courtesy of Colour Tone paints, all you need to do is SMS the word Colour Tone to 32010. It is as easy as that, and you can win for yourself, for your club, a White Line Fever Sports Colour Tone marker hamper. Last week's winner, Brackenfell. Congratulations, Brackenfell. You win for yourself a White Line Fever hamper courtesy of Colour Tone paints. All you need to do, folks, SMS that number now and you can win those lines markers for your club. Colour Tone paints, Available at a store near you. The White Line Sportsline field marker of choice. Time for us to take an ad break. We'll be back with you in a minute. Question in from Facebook. Folks, look at these teddy bears. We're looking for more teddy bears and toys for the kids. Don't these look absolutely amazing? Michael, my... there he is. Teddy bear. Look at this. Okay, I've got to actually get myself a little teddy bear here as well. Like, hello. Little teddy bear. There's your teddy bear for the kayakies. Yeah. Oh, little Hixi, hello, how are you? Oh my heavens. I mean, can you believe it? Here's some grown men and ungrown men also. We're having fun. I mean, Mr. H, it's something special. Eh?
Just imagine the fun the kids will have.
Can you hear that? I mean, really. On a more serious note, you know, these kind of toys are also donated to police stations for kids that have been under traumatized environment. So, folks, really, I'm waiting for you to jump on the Facebook. Okay? You want me to come out to your club and do... Okay, let me blackmail you then. You want me to come out to your club next year with a camera? You better get on the screen right now, okay? But no, absolutely. On Facebook, talking about Facebook, I got a question here from David Moses. JP, about the 30 clubs, why don't the clubs in Northern Suburbs use Hardekraalkie? Why use Newlands? Clubs in Paarl and more, also part of Western Province, need to pass Belleville and go to Newlands. This is, of course, David referring to the 30 clubs that are undergoing this conditioning and training program. Mr. H, simple question. Why do they have to go to Newlands?
Simple answer. HPC doesn't have the facilities to do that kind of testing.
But this is specifically something that sports science is presenting.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's the location.
That's the location.
Okay, okay. So the people that are presenting it are based at Sports Science.
That's correct.
Okay. All right, David, hopefully that answers your question. Danny, if we look forward to next year in terms of 2012 and the youth that are rolling out, you've got now South Africa's biggest rugby show that you're on, and the people want to know. And weekly I put Mr. H on the spot where we give him an opportunity to... Basically, we point the finger at him. Over the years, there have been the odd negative comments about Western Province rugby, and this year we've actually had to put him on the chopping block a few times, and Mr. H has been forced to come back to us with answers from Western Province Rugby Football Union. Luckily, all positive. If I put you on the chopping block, what can we expect from youth rugby over the next 2 or 3 years? Where are we going?
Part of our mission is to firstly grow the game. We have, at the moment, over 170 high schools and clubs playing rugby on a Saturday or during the week. So we would like to have rugby at every school. Secondly, we want to look at improving the quality of the game on the field. And in Western Province, we know Western Province Rugby Football Union has this motto, we want to be the best union in the world. Mm. So we follow them and say we want to be the best schools union in the world. Now, we are blessed, JP, we have a number of schools with great rugby academies. We have Paul Roos, you know, Sachs, where players are actually, where the schools provide a great rugby base for them.
Trafalgar
too, the quality, of, I mean, the amount of players there, but we are challenged with regard to poorer schools and clubs around getting the better players through the system.
Right.
And so we're looking at improving. So we're looking at selecting 45 boys.
Okay.
And sending them to the School of Excellence where they can receive specialist training.
You know? One of the things we also want to encourage, and Mr. H, I was thinking that actually this is something that should start happening now already from a Western Province Rugby Football Union point of view, is we want the youth that are coming out of school to start signing up at a club nearby. Start registering, build the ranks of Western Province Rugby. Is that something we want to encourage? So let me ask Danny, I mean, do the clubs make enough effort to go to the schools?
Some do.
Some, but not
many
enough.
Don't.
Many don't.
And I believe that one of the you're right, we need to get the, you know, to keep the escalator from schools to clubs going.
Yes.
And I think the union has done, gone a long way by starting an under-20 league and encouraging clubs to open an under-20 league.
Because from what I'm seeing, and we've heard one or two comments in the newspaper, what I'm seeing is that there are one or two clubs one or two clubs out of the 90 clubs who say, well, the club system is not working. For the other clubs that have been watching this show and enjoying the community of club rugby, they all seem thrilled that it's been a fantastic season, but yet one or two clubs complain. And if I look at that club, it seems to me that one of the reasons that they're complaining is because their clubs are struggling, but one of the reasons their clubs are struggling is because they haven't done enough to engage the schools in the area to come and play club rugby. Is that right, Mustache? Would you agree with me?
You're quite right, you know. We must remember, the harder you work and the more effort you put in, the bigger the rewards will be.
So if you haven't got money, you need to do something else to your club to encourage people to come play.
Absolutely.
Danny, thank you very much. Hopefully we'll have you on the show in a lot, because we want to make sure that we keep in touch with the youth. I know the youth are going to register. Steph, hard luck this year, but we wish you guys the best of luck for next year. We know you won the South African Conference and was actually a fantastic season for Western Province. Didn't polish it off in the end, but...
Looking forward to 2012?
Yeah, always. Yeah. I think you guys always do a great job. Last year, you won absolutely everything except that one trophy. Had Skark on the show. But we are proud of you guys, and the people out there are faithfully loyal to Western Province.
Perfect, thank you.
And of course, we'll get you back on the show, because we need to figure out more about the nutrition and training. Folks, I want your toys, and I want your money, honey. Okay, so I want the toys, and get hold of Mr. H at the union. For me, we'll see you guys soon. Have a great rugby evening. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.